Smart cities, ensuring better tomorrow. In this session, we have industry perspective, have perspective from states, perspective from municipal corporation as well, and also organizations like Metro Rail Corporation. We are hopeful it will be a fruitful discussion. And to start with that, I would like to invite panelists on stage. I request Sri Rajiv Yadwanshi, Commissioner cum Secretary, Department of Urban Development, Andaman and Nicobar Administration, to please join us on stage. And I request a round of applause for him. Then I request Ms. Namrata Kalsi, Deputy Chief Architect, Delhi Metro Rail Corporation. Please welcome ma'am with a round of applause. Sri Gaurav Jaisinghania, in charge of Smart City Cell, Bhopal Municipal Corporation. I invite you, sir, on stage. Bhopal Municipal Corporation
is
also partnering with this initiative, ELETS Knowledge Exchange Goa 2015. And one more partner of ELETS Knowledge Exchange and a very important representative of industry, I would like to invite Sri Prashant Chaudhary, Senior Director, Sales Government, CA Technologies, on stage. CA Technologies. A round of applause for Prashant, please, once again. And then I will hand over the session to our moderator, Shri Gaurav Jaisinghania.
Team panelists and everybody in the audience. I know it's a session post-lunch, but I'll try to keep it light and just cover the perspective as quickly as possible. Just wanted to bring this slide in front of you, and there are many aspects when we talk about from a smart city perspective. But I'll primarily touch on the technological factor, which are key to any smart city. So if you look at, there are factors like economic, environmental, social, but everything, I think the key word which we have to capture here is the smart, which in between, and let's see how technology plays a key role to make things smarter here. The elements I don't have to talk about, and I'm definitely not a great expert on this one, but if you look at the key components of smart cities are definitely how do we have transportation in a particular city, how do we take care of the services which are more catering to utilities, waste management, things like crime management, and even education. So can technology play a key role there to make sure that every component of the city can be converted into smart by leveraging the technologies which are available? So when you talk about transportation, and obviously you look at the traffic, which is definitely key concern for larger cities, but at the same time it is not just the road traffic we talk about, things like, and I'm sure ma'am will talk about the metro part of it and how it plays a crucial role in making cities smarter as well. Utilities, it's not just about getting a supply, but also how do we use IT-based solutions which can actually convert each of our utility into a smarter and makes a citizen life much easier to use and be in as part of the smart city. Waste management, can we leverage things like sensor, leverage the technology and move forward from there. Education, online education, and I'm sure I think most of you would have seen ads like IDEA, which talks about nothing but online education, but it's nothing leveraging IT and bringing it to masses, the education part of it. And crime, multiple projects which happen across various states, which actually are again based on surveillance, which at the back end, if you look at, are definitely leveraging technology to make sure that all the crime part is taken care and there is continuous surveillance which is happening. So this is a journey which already has started parallelly. So I'll just come to quickly, having said the context here, if you look at from a evaluation, we are moving forward from a purely non-IT environment to this is where we are today. If you look at, this is definitely complex. The next slide which says, This is definitely, I think, the vision which most of the states, whoever are moving towards setting up a smart city. It talks about everything other than IT here, but let me assure you, each one of the components which is listed here, somewhere IT at the back end plays a crucial role. And when I refer to IT, it can be IT in form of large IT infrastructure which is being set up at the back end, which can be in form of a data center, which can be in form of networks which is being laid out, the end mile connectivity, which can be in form of sensors, the meters which are over there, and security will always remain a concern irrespective of whatever topic is there. So whether we talk about cloud computing, we talk about smart cities, we talk about a general SDC or a SWAN from an e-governance perspective, security definitely has to be there. You can't just keep it open for everyone to come in and look at your crucial data. This is another aspect I like to bring in today's application economy. Even governments are today moving away. So just to give you an IT perspective out, from a smart city, if you look at, and if you talk about from applications which are the key component of any smart city, which are driving the execution of services which are in any of the cities over there. From an IT perspective, I think anybody who is looking at from a management part of it, you can set up a smart city, but if you don't have the complete capability to monitor and have to also control the IT services of which are being run, you will end up in trouble. So you make sure that where the problem is in your IT infrastructure, you want to make sure that is taken care of. Also, at the same time, don't depend on saying where the application, where the apps are. It is irrespective of today you use a mobile, you use a cloud, or use a web-based application. Everything should be managed from end-to-end perspective. Also extending, today if you look at from, if I talk about the consumption of mobile phones, and I think yesterday our honorable governor also gave an example that the mobile phone today is with everyone. The only difference today is how many are smartphones and how many are not. It is not far away when each one of them will move into smartphones. So today, extending those management capabilities to your handheld devices, so somebody who is responsible, and it is not just about a smart city, any IT technology person who want to manage the IT environment should have this capability to allow and management of complete IT infrastructure on a simple handheld devices. You should be able to take care of that. What happens in an internet minute? Just quickly moving to the next part of it. I don't have to talk about it. I think each one of you somewhere are involved, and we contribute in that one single internet minute, whether it's a mobile application, whether it's a LinkedIn, whether it's a Facebook. Each one of us actually generating the amount of traffic which is getting generated here. And the future is definitely, the growth is staggering. So if you talk about the amount of traffic which will happen, even the smart cities will contribute hugely to that, because everything will be dependent on internet. And the entire data, the entire processing, sourcing of that data will happen through internet. So I think that also is one area which, or the aspect we need to cater to. Security is what I wanted to hint on here when I talk about the amount of traffic being generated. And this is gone, actually. These are like past, but we always like to refer to something saying that. But the new reality is, today we are opening our application, they are coming on cloud platform. We are also allowing users to bring in their social apps in a work environment. So they are allowed to use Facebook, they are allowed to operate LinkedIn within an official environment. And also if you look at one of the data which talks about it, the APIs which are published every minute, every hour, which is allowing outside world to connect to your application. And a smart city, if we say we will not be integrating with the outside world, it's not possible. So that is another security concern for most of the states and smart city architecture, saying that how do we make it secure? Because if a single hack or an attack on a smart city IT environment can bring the entire city down, that's definitely one of the biggest concern to protect it as well. So the impact can be larger because of externalization of the business, because we are opening it up, blurring of work and personal. So you, the user, it's more user dependent, and you're allowing him to open more application. And obviously the data has always been the point of contention, that who has access to what kind of a data in this. So loss of identity, loss of data control will remain the key concern for everybody over there. And regardless to say that 50 billion connected things by 2020, so it is growing faster here, so we will have to really take care of from the security perspective. So just want to give you from a government perspective, you will open your environment to partners, social registration, developer community, because you want them to create apps which are based on your environment, and where if you look at the platform will be cloud, mobile, apps. And from a complete open and modular security perspective, identity is where, how do you take care of the complete security around identities, how do you take care from an access perspective, SaaS is another area, and finally API management. So can we really have a holistic view of providing a complete security in a smart city environment? Finally, just coming to the last part of my presentation, which is, and this has been a biggest pain for most of the governments today, whether irrespective of the project, I don't have to talk about it, because the challenge for government today has been to roll out faster apps and application. Because today the dependence is so sequential that if one step one happens, then you move to step two and then to step three. The idea is to actually reduce that dependency on multiple system, because today the application environment is complex for most of the governments, and they have to do testing, they have to do third party integration, and the dependence on this kind of environment causes a concern over there. So if you look at from using technology, you can talk about constraint free development, continuous application delivery, by taking out the complete manpower and making it much more automated and monitoring part of it. So the constraint, take away the constraint, whether it is because of third party system or application not being available, using concepts like application delivery under DevOps, you should be able to do that easily. And then with concept like service virtualization, you can actually do simulations of third party environment and do those application creations much faster and be agile, which is demand of today's environment. So on a high level, I'll not get into detail, just talk about from a very high level smart city architecture. So IT plays a very crucial role. My only submission here is, please don't neglect IT when you actually design and do that. So I'm sure IT has now its own importance over there. From a security, even from a larger framework, we want to make sure that from day one, not later, because that's the challenge which I have seen governments face. We roll out application, everything, and then we think about security. I think it has to be when the part of the design and not later. So business rewritten by software, I think that's what we believe in, and today business are actually getting changed by how the software is and how do we use apps over there. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prashant. So before we move on to the panel discussion, a couple of minutes of presentation from ELITS on our initiatives, what we are taking in terms of smart cities, and also to throw some light on the points of discussion in this session. My colleague Garima Pant is there for that.
The session would focus on building smart cities, ensuring a better tomorrow. ELITS had envisioned this concept of smart city in 2010, much before anyone else. And the organization has been providing a knowledge sharing platform in the support of Government of India's vision of building smart cities. It has been engaging key stakeholders from both the government and the industry through publications, portals, and summits in realizing the Smart City dream. A glimpse of our Smart City events that have happened. This was Smart City 2014, 2010. We also had a 2011 Smart City event. And coming up, Smart City 2015. This conference will be happening in the month of July, and the event will focus on the various aspects of a smart city, including urban development, power, energy transport, technology, green building, network, and communication technology. The session that we are having today will focus on defining the concept of smart city, how use of ICT can be leveraged to build smart cities, state perspectives, and the role of urban development departments, municipal corporations, and other state departments in the development of cities into smart cities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Garima. And thank you, Mr. Prashant, for giving us executive insight of the importance of IT in building smart cities. Now I would like to request Ms. Namita Kalsi to come over the stage and give a presentation of what Delhi has been fetching out of the smart cities concept. And she's Deputy Chief Architect of Delhi Metro Corporation, and she'll be speaking about the metro as well as the history of Delhi, which has already been reflecting the smart cities concept. Please. Chief Secretary, Government of Goa also, he's here, and he would, at the end of the session, he will also be speaking about the smart cities concept, what Goa is fetching out of smart cities. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Mrs. Kalsi, Namrita Kalsi, from Delhi Metro Rail Corporation. And since 2012, we have been working on certain concepts at a city level that how to make the city better. Meanwhile, the smart challenge has arrived in India, which is likely to transform India. So I'll be discussing certain points with respect to not exactly a case study. Case study is when the things happen. But case in point, because in Delhi, these are ongoing. So with respect to smart city, what I can actually say is that we are not only building 100 smart cities, but also redoing 500 cities that are what people think are not smart at this point of time. That is brownfield. So probably I would be discussing more of second point, because that is what Delhi is. So when we think about redoing or resetting or co-setting of a city, we have to go back into the past, because that is where the things actually originated. So Delhi is one of the oldest inhabited city of the world, and it is the longest reigning capital, and that is why it has got a very elegant past. And not to mention the Lutyens' Delhi, which is one of the most famous urban areas of the world. And this is, I should not forget, the Britishers were also compelled to move their capital from Calcutta to Delhi, maybe because of its strategic location. So with this, Delhi would have continued like this had an event in history not taken place in 1947. And within 3 years, the population of Delhi doubled. And we had municipal authorities. Were they capable to handle such a lot of influx during such a traumatic time? Thereafter, Delhi Development Authority was conceptualized to handle such problems, which are still creating, you know, a lot of issues today, even after 58 years. But there's a good news also. After 58 years, Delhi is the place to live. People will find 100, 200,000 reasons to live here. But what about our concerns? Maybe those concerns are opportunities for some of the people here. So let's have a look into it. The first is the sewerage. That's the first layer in the town planning. 1600 unauthorized colonies, 1000 jhuggi clusters, 189 villages. They are not covered by it. Transport. Although I am very proud my department has done very well, but on its peak day when it covered 27.1 lakh people, which is just out of 1.67 crore, where are we today on the second layer of town planning, that is transport? Third layer, water. Only 45% of the source of water is reliable. Sorry, unreliable. So how much we have reliable, that you can calculate. Solid waste. 85% of the garbage is going into the landfill. Power politics. See, this government. Pani, bijli, and these things. So many years after independence, we have not been able to, you know, get over these things. And we want to reach the smart. How will we do it? Now, this is vote politics. There are 60 lakh people living in 1939 unauthorized colonies of Delhi. And of course, safety and security. Not to mention the media strength of disaster management. So what do we do? Do we use our three fingers, control, alternate, delete? And smart it up. But can we do it in a short time? We can't wipe out the people's houses, their dreams. So what do we do? So Delhi has come out with 7 laws. Of course, it will take very slowly because these have been incentivized. First is the development, in which the incentivization has been extra FAR. And this is where we reach. And what is in it for the government? They charge the extra FAR and they also charge unearned increased from the land. And O&M is on the basis of PPP mode. Second is redevelopment. Of course, it has more sweetener, you have more FAR, and you also have certain land uses which are extra than purely redevelopment. So what do? You reach here. From here to here, which is at an individual level, and this is at a community level. A similar thing is there for the residential as well. Third law is conversion, which again has more sweetener and it has more thing in it for the government. They charge at the rate of current rate of land. So this money actually goes into rebuilding the city infrastructure. Industry in non-conforming area, unauthorized colony. I think it's an unmanageable thing on which the governments win or lose their elections. Now, when we are doing all kind of development, the greatest concern is parking. So there are certain laws for parking as well, but that's not the solution. How do we inbuild development and parking? So we have the fifth law, that is transit-oriented development, which gives a higher FAR, mixed-use development, and higher densities, and amalgamation, reconstitution, and you don't have to transfer land to the government. They shrink it. We'll be shrinking it. This law is yet to come. And sixth law is land pooling, whereby you transfer your land and you will get something lesser than what you had earlier. And last of all, on all these layers, everybody wishes to dovetail the smart. Now, what is our clientele? Who are the people who will live here? They are young working class. They are smart consumers. They have smartphones. They have smart lifestyles. And you know, we have been watching the smart city development very closely, and we just learned that, you know, it has been given to the local body. But is that the solution? I was thinking that there will be different smart city laws in which will be CEO driven. or maybe they combine the local bodies and the urban authorities to work together, that the agency which is doing the development is also actually looking after it. Otherwise, there's always this sink problem. And the consumer, he wants hassle-free, universal accessibility, one bill, 365 into 24, water, energy, web services, and that also at an affordable rate. So now, here we put it all together. See, what I had done is before and after. So here, now it is on the other side. Before, the services, especially the IT part, was the last thought. Now what will happen, that it will be a central concept around which the whole city will be designed. Earlier we were linear, first the land, then the this, then the this, then the this. Now it will be collaborative. Everybody will be working together. Earlier it was multi-agency, and what I feel, it should be one control center. The entire thing should be dealt by one person. ये नहीं कि DC office में registry हो रही है, दूसरी जगह land use plan बन रहा है, तीसरी जगह उसको implementation approval के लिए, that should not be there. Only then this concept will be successful. And thereafter we will get this kind of a city. And thank you very much for listening to me so closely.
Thank you, Namita ma'am. Thank you for sensitizing us with the issues and problems and the patchwork that has to be done before we move towards the smart city. Next, I would call upon Sri Rajiv Yadvanshi ji, Commissioner cum Secretary, Government of Andaman and Nicobar. He is taking care of the Department of Urban Development, and he would be speaking of what we call smart cities concept. And as you know, Andaman and Nicobar is a big island with a population of around 4 lakhs. So it would be a different challenge to work upon smart cities project when we consider such island which is a union territory. Maybe for the deeper insight, I would call upon Rajiv Yadvanshi sir, and a round of applause.
Respected Chief Secretary, members on the dais, esteemed invitees for the delegate function. I know it's an afternoon session. It's a difficult topic, very big topic, and to have your attention, I'd be grateful. I see that smart city is a place for an opportunity for a citizen as well as for an entrepreneur. The government and the local government have to play a very important role, both in urban development, and the panchayats are state functions. What you see is a citizen who's more digitized. He has got a mobile phone, a very powerful instrument in his hand, and which has become a part of his human body. And he expects that all the things, all the data, everything comes to him. And this is a tremendous potential, because connected with the mobile and his identity in terms of Aadhaar, he is ready to have access to all information. He is ready to go anywhere. He is ready to connect to people, places, institutions, everywhere. He is more aware. His abilities increase. His expectations increase. He wants a better quality of life. And will demand a better service from the government, whether it is a state government or it is a local body. The entrepreneur, if you see the market forces, is also trying to integrate or connect both the producer and consumer anywhere. That is a marketing concept. The producer of goods and services is trying to connect to the consumer of goods and services. And gone are the days where you're looking for profit only. Now the days is to reduce the cost, to increase the efficiencies, and ease of doing business. I think these are the prime concerns for any entrepreneur. And he's in search of constantly in terms of skilled manpower and the markets. And he also views a smart city as an opportunity. So what I see and what I can foresee, I have worked in Delhi government as additional secretary of urban development. Then I came to Goa government, I handled the urban development and also the rural development panchayat, and now handle the Andamans as urban development. What I see is this smart city is a place, whether you call it a city or a semi-city or any place, is a conversion of skills. The skills would translate into activity and the enterprise would follow in. And everything else has to follow that. This involves that your costing and your pricing has to be efficient. And there are demand and supply concerns which also have to be gone into. In that sense, for a smart city, the government has got a responsibility to create a systems and standards for future functions and services, so that the place of opportunity which is identified does not die with time. So the options before the government are, whether it is a state government or the local government, is to remodel the existing city by identifying gaps and calculate the costs. The other way is to make new ones and calculate costs. So ultimately it comes to cost. And smart city is not a single time process. It's a continuous process. It's not that you do one thing at one point of time, as a one-time effort and forget about it. It involves continuous working on it. Now, what is the place and what is the model to follow for urbanization or whatever the smart city is? It has been said that you increase the urbanization rate, your opportunities increase. So the states are there which are having say 10 to 20% of urbanization, they would like to increase more. There are bigger cities who are having big mega institutions which need to be broken down, remodeled. And then there are satellite towns which will extend from the existing city as a new development. And there's a new development with new townships, it will involve a time lag. So all this has to be factored into, but it gives you clean slate to start with. Because as the previous speaker has spoken, if you build something, to remodel is a very high cost alternative. Now we also got an exposure today morning with Honorable Chief Minister, where he mentioned about the Goa in detail. And when I was working here, I saw this is a unique place where you have 50% urbanization, 50% rural area. So it's not exclusively urban, it's not exclusively rural. 50-50%. So it is an urban-rural continuum. Why I say this? Because the urban area in Goa does not look like an urban area, what we say in bigger cities. And the rural area would not look like the traditional rural area. So something like a rural-urban continuum. There are various states which are into this mode, maybe small size states, which are 5,000 square kilometers, 10,000 square kilometers, like Goa, or even if you go down south, Kerala is also in that category only. They would like to say that we are comfortable living in our villages, why should we go to the urban areas? And why should we model into this way? And we had a place like Punjab. Yesterday Chief Secretary Punjab had said, why a smart city? I'm more comfortable with a smart village. So that's also a concept we can build upon. So whatever be the model or place we want to build on, whether it's a smart city or a smart village, it has to be a team's work between the state government and the local government. And there are issues on that, because there is always a rub or a discontinuum between the state government and the local government, because they have elected representative, there is a rub, there is something like that. So when we are saying, coming back to the comparative advantages of producing and consuming, if we have to produce and consume, we have to convert the skills and activities and the entrepreneurs also. So the skills have to be ultimately linked to a product. Where to do it and what type of product or services have to be made. There is a simple concept that you build from micro, go to macro. An example of this is one taluka, one product. This is what I had, this is my idea. This is known as OTOP, one taluka, one product. You identify one product where you can specialize in. That is your comparative advantage. You can break it from the taluka level go to panchayat also. You make it one product, one panchayat, one product. And you can build it at a bigger aggregate. I'll explain it by this example. Yesterday, Punjab secretary said, they are experts in agriculture in producing paddy and wheat. That is in their talukas, it is a village. I happened to go there in Punjab and study. So there they said, our only culture is agriculture. Well, they are very confident and they are proud of their culture. And they should continue doing because that is an advantageous position. So it becomes an advantage as a product for the entire state. And they are building into their digitization, etc., into that. So that is one concept. The other way to look at it is, in one municipality, you identify one product. Or within, if the municipality is wrong, is a very large one, you, within the wards of the municipality, you identify one product. So you build the aggregates and then you have economies of scale. Why this would be advantages is the opportunity cost of producing a auto product should be greater than the transport cost. So the product will find its market. Definitely it will be advantages. Now the crucial link, the human link. The citizen who has a mobile, he starts from his home, goes to a place of work. The travel time to his place of work and back, I think should not be more than 2 hours roughly. Otherwise it's not good for him, it's not good for the state also. So what a smart city would feel, or what a place is, that where all the citizens, the government and entrepreneurs come together, build infrastructure. Now, how to build infrastructure? There are huge amount of issues and everything. If I go into it, it will take a lot of time. Just to briefly go into this, transport is one issue. You want to travel to your workplace, come back home very fast. It should be safe, secure. And if you can do your work at home, why travel at all? So here, digitization and technology comes in a big way. Another thing is that our Manrega scheme, which is happening in our rural areas, people are comfortable in the villages, they're getting employment. So if we are able to build and technology to their homes, yesterday Telangana was made a good presentation that not only the water is being taken there, but the optical cable is also being taken there. Why not? Why not build more efficiencies on that? Power. These are already transmission, generation, distribution. I think everybody is aware that it has already taken and stabilized. Tariff and regulator has come into being. Privatization has happened. Water supply. When I was there in Delhi, power had been, it was taken out of the municipal function, converted into a board. Later on, board converted into companies. Similarly, water supply and sewage disposal undertaking, which was part of municipality, is taken out. And another organization created, went for a World Bank loan. Crucial part is, if you're wanting to manage water, identify the target of liter per capacity per day of your population. Then, based on the consumption, calculate water treatment plants, efficiency in use, reduce your T&D losses, and one more important thing is, don't harden your surfaces of the urban areas, because groundwater charging will not happen. Sewage is also linked to water. How much you consume will also go into your disposal systems. Another issue, stormwater drains. If we don't plan our sewage systems well, the so-called stormwater drains will become sewers as time passes. This is a classic example of what happened in Delhi. MSW, you know, segregation is at source, speedy collection and disposals. All these areas are open to private entrepreneurship, which can happen. Other areas are there which can also develop in a very big way, which are the social side, health, healthy living, more sports, more exercise. As you're handling technology, you're more sitting the day. You need to exercise, you need to play. The previous session, a lot of thing was there. You would have gaming. Security and surveillance issue, you know this Nirbhaya case, what had happened. Government took a hit. Not government's fault, but it happened. Then your housing, slums, unauthorized colonies, these are big issues. Lastly, disaster management. The structural engineering which happened in cities When I was in Delhi, some earthquakes happened. Courts had to intervene, and they said, "You please set up your standards for the constructions." And there in unauthorized colonies particularly, it was not built on beams and columns, it was just brick on brick. So we asked structural engineers, our architects, they need more capacity building to build safer structures as time goes by. Of course, capacity building, we also have to take our elected representatives in the panchayat and in the municipal bodies also along. Otherwise, if they don't do that, it goes in different directions. Then, coming to the financing and calculation of costing. What is per capita cost for urbanization? That has to be calculated if you have to plan well. Government of India has worked out in its smart cities concept a per capita investment of nearly 43,386 for a 20-year period. I don't know how they have calculated, but it gives an indication that you have to plan for your cost per capita. Now, working backward, what is the cost of creation of a service? Then what is the cost of maintenance of a service? These factors have to be taken into consideration. Why I say this? Because ultimately, if you have to invite a private investment into it, because government will not be able to invest fully into this, so both the partners have to get it together. And there's a lot of transparency process needed in the thing, because if you have to do the financing, your model concession agreement have to be in place. You have to calculate not only your cost but also your revenues very well. Make it transparent. Somebody should not get a fast gain, but a reasonable gain. Then your cost-benefit analysis has to be done by a third party. That will build a confidence among the investors, particularly if you want to do the PPP mode. And also if you want to invite private investment in these sectors, which are also crucial. And lastly, how do you finance? We have the State Central Finance Commission, we have the State Finance Commissions. They are not in sync. So our State Finance Commissions have to be in sync with the Central Finance Commission so that they are at the correct time. And the funding comes, how now we are having the GST also in place. So the fiscal financing and the GST, this leveraging will happen. More funds will be available, more faster funds. And it is in time for an allocation that the state government takes will take an opportunity to share more of the funding with the local bodies and make them more capacity oriented so as to rise to the occasion of making a smart city. Lastly, tax. If there is a negative externality, tax. If you have to subsidize, if there is a positive externality, subsidize, but calculate it properly. Then differential pricing of services. Water, power. If you are a low consumer, lesser tariff. Higher consumer, differential pricing. You have to reduce your cost ultimately. I think lastly, self-financing versus loan decision. That has a crucial decision by the states. You have to come to a conclusion whether you are able to finance it yourself or want to take a loan. And this is a very important decision because it helps, it has an effect on your future budgets. Thank you so much.
Levels and giving us a smart cities perspective of urban development in Andaman and Nicobar. Municipal corporation being the local implementing agency and urban local body to implement any of the projects, either it be GenNURM or smart cities or any kind of thing. I was asked to keep the municipal perspective of smart cities. So in case you don't sleep, I would not give a presentation today. Instead, I would speak a bit about Bhopal and smart cities and rather seek for solutions and call for proposals to be put for Bhopal and other cities of Madhya Pradesh as well. Like we have been talking about nine pillars of ICT for past 2 days, there are four pillars that we usually talk when it comes to smart cities. The four pillars that we have for smart cities in the presentation given by Namita ma'am as well as by the Mr. Rajiv from Mr. Prashant from C Technologies as well as Rajiv sir, all comes to four basic pillars, that is physical infrastructure, social infrastructure, institutional infrastructure, and of course the financial infrastructure being the backbone.
These four pillars under smart cities generally refer to enhancing the infrastructure, like what we have already made in different. For major cities in India, JNNURM did the job of creating the infrastructures, including e-governance, municipal administration system, water supply, sewer lines, public transport, and few more. Well, physical infrastructure not having a direct reference to the current discussion creates a basic, what physical infrastructure does is, physical infrastructure creates a basic ground for ICT to ICT, information communication technology to chip in. What happens is Bhopal, being, Bhopal has a GSM based street light system. I'll elaborate about it. In Bhopal, we have street lights which have a GSM support system. What we do is, usually we set timers for the street lights through mobile phones. We, from our cell phone, the control cell phone, we give signals to 10 street lights that, you know, if the time is set on street light 10, there is a code for 10 street lights, codes are given and then set on at 6:30 p.m. So automatically those street lights will open up at 6:30 p.m. in the evening. In case if there's any for example, if any bulb has been fused or there's no electricity connection that is reaching the street light, what happens is there's a SMS received by the controller's mobile phone from the street light that there is an error. So that we get a point, you know, there's some error, we chip in, and this is how it works. Basically, enhancing the infrastructure talks about smart cities. Ab street light nahi hoga, toh fir there is no role played by GSM based smartphone also. Abhi Bhopal ka ek aur example I'll give you. Bhopal mein humne 10 citizen facility centers established kiye hue. We have online bill payment system also. Par बात वहीं आती है कि पानी की अगर सप्लाई नहीं होगी तो फिर वाटर मीटरिंग सिस्टम या वाटर टैक्स ऑनलाइन पेमेंट का सवाल ही नहीं उठता. तो पहले जो पहला स्टेप है वो है इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर क्रिएट करना, और फिर दूसरा स्टेप है कि उस इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर को एनहांस करना, दैट इज मेकिंग आवरसेल्फ स्मार्ट, आवर सिटीज स्मार्ट. वेल, माय पॉइंट इज देयर आर टू कंपोनेंट्स व्हेन इट कम्स टू मेकिंग द स्मार्ट सिटीज, क्रिएटिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एंड एनहांसिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. भोपाल और मध्य प्रदेश ही नहीं, भारत के अधिकांश शहरों में 10 साल पहले पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट की स्थिति बहुत ही दयनीय थी, आप सभी को पता है. JNNURM हैज डन द जॉब ऑफ क्रिएटिंग द गिविंग द यूनानिमस पब्लिक बस सिस्टम. आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट दोज JNNURM बसेस दैट यू सी इन पुणे, इन जयपुर, इन भोपाल, इन दिल्ली, इन एवरीवेयर इन द कंट्री दैट यू सी दोज बसेस, रेड बसेस, ग्रीन बसेस. मैम की प्रेजेंटेशन में भी एक फोटो था दिल्ली का जिसमें वो रेड बस था. तो जो ये हम जो नाउ व्हेन वी हैड दिस एसी कंफर्टेबल बसेस, वी हैव एनहांस्ड द सेफ्टी सिस्टम आल्सो बाय प्लेसिंग जीपीएस बेस्ड मॉनिटरिंग एंड द सीसीटीवी कैमरास. ऑफ कोर्स अ नोट हैज बीन टेकन टू व्हाट मिस्टर गौतम सेड यस्टरडे कि सीसीटीवी को भी सीसीटीवी की मॉनिटरिंग चाहिए. चक्कर यह है कि हम सीसीटीवी लगा देते हैं लेकिन अब सीसीटीवी के ऊपर भी सीसीटीवी लगाना पड़ता है ये देखने के लिए सीसीटीवी काम कर रहा है कि नहीं कर रहा. तो ICT जो इन्फॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी है कहीं ना कहीं उसमें बीच बीच में कहीं कहीं लीकेजेस हो जाते हैं, जिसको मॉनिटर किया जाए तो वी कैन मूव टुवर्ड्स हैविंग अ स्मार्टर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ऑल्सो. देर आर टू थिंग्स एज आई टॉक्ड अबाउट, क्रिएटिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एंड एनहांसिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. IT ऑफकोर्स हैज 90% रोल टू प्ले इन एनहांसिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. I have been hearing of tentative figures recently. अभी सर ने भी बात किया 100 स्मार्ट सिटीज, 100 टू बी स्मार्ट सिटीज, और अभी रिसेंटली बात हुआ 500 अटल अमृत सिटीज, अमृत योजना सिटीज ऑल्सो. दीज आर द सेम टू थिंग्स दैट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट. आई मीन फर्स्ट वो 100 सिटीज हैं, दोज 100 सिटीज फॉर वे एनहांसिंग द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, दस मेकिंग देम स्मार्ट, जिनको हम स्मार्ट करेंगे. देन वी हैव 500 सिटीज विच डोंट हैव बेसिक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर येट. अभी मैं बीच में एक दिन बनारस के एक सज्जन व्यक्ति थे, उनसे मैं बात कर रहा था कि आप क्या, व्हाट इज द सिस्टम ऑफ सॉलिड वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट और से वाटर सप्लाई, और दे सेड यू नो देयर इज नथिंग. जहाँ पे बोरवेल्स होते हैं तो चूंकि इट इज एन बेसिन ऑफ रिवर गंगा, तो द वाटर टेबल इज गुड देयर. सो ही सेड, दे सेड यू नो जहाँ बोरिंग है वहाँ बोरिंग करके वी फेच वाटर, और जहाँ बोरिंग नहीं है वहाँ पे पब्लिक सप्लाई गवर्नमेंट की रहती है. बट देर इज नो सिमिलैरिटी बिटवीन द वाटर सप्लाई ऑल थ्रू द सिटी. या सॉलिड वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट के लिए भी अगर हायर एंड सोसाइटीज हैं, दे हैव डोर टू डोर कलेक्शन. बट क्या हुआ है कि जो 4-7 जेनेन्यू आर एम सिटीज़ दैट वी हैव हैड इन पास्ट 10 ईयर्स, जिसमें इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर को क्रिएट किया है. ये जो 60-70 सिटीज़ जिनकी मैं बात कर रहा हूँ, जिनको 100 स्मार्ट सिटीज़ बनाने में हम लोग आगे की तरफ बढ़ रहे हैं, दीज आर द सिटीज़ वेयर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर वॉज क्रिएटेड. नाउ इट्स द टर्न वेन देर आर टू बी मोर सिटीज़ टू कम इन, जिनको अभी तक भी बेसिक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर नहीं है, लाइक वाराणसी and Solapur, Kolhapur, or nearby there are Belgaum also, there's a city. So these are the cities wherein, you know, we'll be creating the infrastructure and then enhancing them later. IT has two role to play in these 100 cities wherein we will be launching the smart cards, metering of the water supply. Partially it is done, but it is to be implemented at 100%. इंटीग्रेशन ऑफ ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स. अभी हम लोग एक प्रॉब्लम फेस कर रहे थे, हमने BRTS में ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स लगाए. BRTS कॉरिडोर है भोपाल का 24 किलोमीटर्स का. भोपाल BRTS इज ऑब्वियसली सक्सेसफुल मॉडल आफ्टर अहमदाबाद. तो BRTS कॉरिडोर में हमने ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स लगाए. टुक अस 1.5 ईयर. रजत सर यहाँ पे हैं मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ होम अफेयर से. मैं सर को कल बता रहा था कि इट टुक अस 1.5 ईयर क्योंकि हमारा पुलिस से इंटीग्रेशन नहीं है. तो ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स जो पुलिस के ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स है उनसे इंटीग्रेट करने में 1.5 साल लग गया. BRTS में वी हैव IT इनेबल्ड ट्रैफिक सिग्नल्स, जो कि जिसमें पुश बटन सिस्टम भी है. पुश बटन, वंस अ पर्सन हैज टू क्रॉस द रोड, ही पुशेस द बटन एंड देन यू नो अकॉर्डिंग टू द टाइमिंग सिग्नल चालू होता है. सॉरी, ही कैन क्रॉस द रोड. बट इशू इज BRTS कॉरिडोर की रास्ते से जो भी निकल जाता था सारे सिग्नल्स क्रॉस करके, जैसे ही वो दोबारा पुलिस के सिग्नल्स में आता था तो वहाँ पे अगेन अ जैम. तो वी इट टुक अस 1.5 ईयर टू इंटीग्रेट द सिस्टम. तो बेसिकली जो है अब ICT विल प्ले अ मेजर रोल इन इंटीग्रेशन ऑफ द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ऑल्सो. GSM बेस्ड LED स्ट्रीट लाइट्स, एज आई टॉक्ड अबाउट, दिस कैन बी अ बिग प्रोजेक्ट दैट यू नो IT हैज टू प्ले अ रोल इन मेकिंग 100 सिटीज स्मार्ट. एंड देन GPS बेस्ड मॉनिटरिंग ऑफ द पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट एंड बेसिकली कट टू कट मॉनिटरिंग ऑफ ऑल द टाइप्स ऑफ बेसिक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर दैट वी हैव इन द ऑलरेडी एग्जिस्टिंग सिटीज. Again, IT has also the major role to play in 500 cities, which are on the way to seek the infrastructure that is in Atal Amrit Yojana or any other scheme that comes in. Isme IT will play a role in bringing automatic building permission approval system. Bhopal and other cities have it. Major cities have it. Providing e-governance and MAS solutions, including e-tendering, etc. Again, Bhopal has it, and other cities of Madhya Pradesh and country also have it. IT enabled monitoring of progress of development works. अभी एक चीज़ और कुछ सिटीज़ में है और भोपाल में भी है, जो कि हमने देखी कि प्रोग्रेस ऑफ द वर्क इज़ पुट बाय सिविल इंजीनियर, जो हमारे सब इंजीनियर असिस्टेंट इंजीनियर होता है. व्हाट दे डू इज़ दे गिव द प्रोग्रेस ऑफ द वर्क ऑनलाइन. कमिश्नर और द कलेक्टर और द कमिश्नर यू अर्बन डेवलपमेंट, ही कैन डायरेक्टली सी इट ऑनलाइन कि अगर कोई काम स्टार्ट हुआ था तो वेयर टू व्हाट एक्सटेंट हैज़ इट रीच्ड. Then lot more things that you people might be knowing better than me. IT will play a major role in this. Majority of basic infrastructure Bhopal already has. Also few of the infrastructures are smart infrastructures. We crave to make our smart infrastructure smarter and other facilities smart. IT investors have lot of opportunities in urban development in these 100 and the upcoming 500 cities. Thus, I invite investors to Bhopal also, come see, analyze and help us in providing facilities and services in smoother way. Thank you and all the best to all the IT investors. Now I would request Honorable Chief Secretary, Government of Goa, to give his opinion and to give his perspective of smart cities, what he feels of smart cities. Maybe he has a better and experienced version of making Indian cities smarter. Sir, I call you upon the stage.
Let me welcome all the delegates here. In the morning session, I was not here. I had to go urgently to Delhi. This morning, I took a flight and I'm here with you. So welcome on behalf of the state government of Goa. A lot of theory has been talked about on a smart city by our colleague Rajiv Vidwanshi and other friends. A presentation on Delhi has already been made. I have attended 2 international conferences in Delhi last year. Sorry, one last year, one this year. which were organized on smart cities by Ministry of Urban Development in association with World Bank. As an estimate, I think it's a thought to ponder over. About 6 million lives are lost in India every year because of insanitary conditions, because of poor quality of water supply, because of lack of hygiene, because of lack of sanitation, because of lack of educational facilities. These precious lives are lost. Now, what is the cost? Each human life cannot be valued. So the concept of a smart city, as we are talking about, it's very easy to develop a smart city in a greenfield situation, which answers all those questions, which addresses all those problems, and also creates, if not world class, at least satisfactory level of infrastructure facilities. The roads, the transportation, the water supply, the drinking water supply, the sewerage system, everything should become smart. When we say smart, what do we mean? If there is a power supply, it should be 24/7 available. It should be, if it is available, it should be quality power. The water supply should be 24/7. When we say that, that means potable water, dependable water, depending on the LPCD norms fixed by the government. And then, when we talk of providing services, it should be properly metered by smart meters. And then, when we talk of billing, it should be paid online. In a greenfield situation, we can develop smart cities, but the challenges are enormous. Everybody knows, I am sure 50% of the people who are sitting here, they don't come from metro towns. We have seen the plight of those B and C grade cities and towns in the country, which are getting worse from one day to another. Their plight is, we cannot even fathom to the level of the problem that the citizens are facing. There is in-migration, creation of all illegal colonies, unauthorized slums, people living in insanitary conditions, lack of sewerage facility, lack of roads, lack of social infrastructure, all is having its toll. The challenges in the cities like Varanasi has been talked about. I will talk about Panjim city, which is a historical city, since we are here. There will be answers. We have to find the answers for retrofitting these cities. A survey was conducted in Delhi, in east part. I think ma'am was talking about Delhi. I have long experience of working in Delhi. For about 30 years I've been there. After Lalita Park, that tragedy, the house which collapsed, we conducted a survey with the help of IIT Delhi people, and 10,000 houses were surveyed, ma'am. None of the house could withstand the structural stability. So if, God forbid, if there is an earthquake, what we had in Nepal, the tragedy will be enormous. We cannot imagine. So the challenge in a city like Delhi, which is the national capital, is how to make those houses worthy of safe living. So retrofitting is a solution. Can we make that part of the city smart? Is a question that is to be answered by those experts who are working in this field. Our problem is, when we find solution to a problem, I feel another problem emerges. A decision was taken by the government of Delhi to make the ring road signal free. What happened? We created more than 40 flyovers. Immediately after, as you descend from the flyover, there is a traffic jam. So one solution needs to another problem. So that problem needs to be solved. Now, I'm just leaving these thoughts for all of you to ponder over. And since I am here, I would talk about certain things, what we are thinking about Goa. We have projected Panjim city to the government of India to be taken up in the first lot, because in any case it will qualify, being a state capital, being a city on the coastline, being a city of tourism importance. Definitely, we also don't have 100% sewerage facility in the Panjim city. Sewerage, 24/7 water supply. Our power supply is very, very good, no doubt about it. But still we are thinking that if this city could be provided 100% sewerage coverage. So we are aiming to get some of the projects on PPP mode or on viability gap funding. The details are being worked out. I hope people are aware. Ministry of Urban Development have already drafted a guideline which is available on their website. It will be finalized very shortly. It will pave way for picking up the projects. The municipalities, the cities will have to compete at the national level as far as projects are concerned. And once the project is finalized by the government, then they will decide the mode of funding the projects. So I wish you all success in this direction, and I hope the challenges which are faced by all of us in urban management are addressed, and this conference, which is basically focused on IT, the IT solutions will come to help solve many of problems. Thank you.
I'd like to have a question session from the people out there. Sir is here, and the panel, elite panel is here. There are distinguished guests on the panel. I would request all of you, any of you, to please raise up a question if you have regarding smart cities and role of IT in smart cities. So, out to the people.
Actually, I just want to flag the difference. Let's say ki about 8 to 9 years back when we used to do the designing, the IT used to, I think, come the last of it. Either they used to put their own wire or baad mein Wi-Fi aa gaya, or bahut agar advanced bhi chal rahe hai, used to be a dedicated thing which could be hired by IT companies. Now in the smart city, that will be the first thing that will be thought. So this is the difference between the two. If earlier when we were designing the city, IT was one of the last. In the smart cities, probably it will be the first thing which will gain the attention of the policy makers.
One question. Yeah. My name is D'Souza. My question is regarding, we are all discussing about the smart cities, but what about the smart communities to support the smart cities? Is there any direction in this regard?
Can you please come again with the question?
The question is, smart cities is discussed a lot, but what about smart communities?
Maybe ma'am would answer.
Actually, you know, up till now, the thinking of the Indian citizen has been that everything will be done by the government. I think by the way of smart communities, we actually mean that the citizen will also become more responsible. Somewhere I feel that will go and dovetail with Swachh Bharat, because it actually boils down to the fact that Indians have to develop a greater sense of civic sense. So this is what my feeling is.
See, when I was working in Delhi urban development, we had just developed the concept of RWA, Resident Welfare Association. So people in cities come from different backgrounds, from various parts of the country. They settle for various reasons, and when living in a place, they have to develop, or that becomes their community. So that RWA becomes a role for integrating that community, and how you take the concept further forward, whether to present your problems to the government, to the local government, and how you can just be live like a community, take care of each other. Or share and care ideas, because you don't live separately, you are part of a building. So one issue, if you are a part of the building, and if your neighbor has an AC, you don't have an AC, so this becomes an issue. So everybody has to get along. So the community living is an important concept. I think there was a program on the radio which was started after that. Mrs. Sheila Dixit was the chief minister, so which linking the communities. And there were a lot of meetings used to happen regularly with the RWAs. Their problems were presented to the state government, and all the organizations which were working in silos, like MCD, big organizations, the problems were taken across to them. So these, cutting across the hierarchies, the verticals, institutional hierarchies, is a big challenge, and that is the real challenge, where you feel secure, you be connected to each other in a living area. I think that answers the thing. Okay.
Maybe I would like to add a point to what Rajiv sir and Amrita ma'am said. मैं नॉर्थन इंडिया की एक सिटी में ट्रैवल कर रहा था, तो मेरे को एमबीबी के मैंने एक सीनियर इंजीनियर साहब से पूछा, मैंने कहा कि आपके यहाँ ये पर्टिकुलर स्ट्रीट है, हम लोग वी वर ऑन अराउंड, तो मैंने बोला कि यहाँ पे मतलब मैं काफ़ी दूर तक देख रहा हूँ कि सोडियम वेपर लैम्प्स लगाए हुए हैं, एलईडी नहीं है, बाकी पूरे शहर में एलईडी है। तो कहना साहब यहाँ तो हमारे यहाँ चोरी हो जाते हैं जी, वो ले जाते हैं घर पे, या तो अपने झुग्गी में लगाते हैं या फिर अपनी जीपों में लगाते हैं। अब दिस इज़ द थिंग दैट इज़ हैपनिंग विद एलईडी लाइट्स ऑफ आई मीन स्ट्रीट एलईडी लाइट्स। सो इट इज़ अपॉन you know there is a civic sense that should be developed, and you know it should come from within self, jo ki hame smarter community banayega. Smarter community jahan hogi wahan smarter adaptability of smart cities bhi hogi.
I think one concept could be that like the extension of the RWA is that the people living in a particular colony or building could form like a social group, intranet, and with their the mobile phone they are connected to each other, they can exchange their problems for make a solutions. I think that would be a good way.
जहाँ ना स्मार्ट कम्युनिटी की बात होती है, अभी सर ने जैसे बोला मुझे एकदम याद आया कि हमने मध्य प्रदेश में एक चालू किया हुआ है कि हम लोग जब कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग करते हैं तो म्यूनसिपल इंजीनियर्स होते हैं, अर्बन डेवलपमेंट सेक्टर में या किसी भी डिपार्टमेंट में इंजीनियर्स होते हैं, तो हम उनकी कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग करते हैं, उनकी कॉन्फ्रेंसेज में, उनको वर्कशॉप्स में इन्वॉल्व करते हैं। मध्य प्रदेश में हमने चालू किया हुआ है, RWAs के जो हेड होते हैं उनको हम मंथली वर्कशॉप्स के लिए बुलाते हैं, कॉन्फ्रेंसेस के लिए बुलाते हैं, उसमें हम लोग उनकी कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग करते हैं, जिससे कि दे शुड नो, लाइक यू नो इफ यू टेल देम अबाउट एलईडी लाइट्स एंड एफिशिएंसी एंड एवरीथिंग, हमने उनको मोबाइल टॉयलेट्स, पब्लिक टॉयलेट्स और सुलभ शौचालय वगैरह के बारे में भी गेव देम वर्कशॉप्स एंड कॉन्फ्रेंसेज, एंड वेरी फ्रीक्वेंट, ऐसा नहीं कि एक का टर्न निकल गया तो आफ्टर एन ईयर, एवरी बाई मंथली दे देर इज अ दिस थिंग कि एक एरिया के किसी ना किसी RWA के प्रेसिडेंट या सेक्रेटरी या किसी की टर्न आती है, so that it there's a trickle down effect ki humne unko trickle kiya to unse fir unki community ko trickle ho, to ek capacity building local elected representatives ki as well as with the RWAs we have to do that, and we have started in MP. ab dekhte sir kaise implement kar pate ho usko.
Hello, one more point I would like to add. When we say smart community, everybody must have seen that the facilities are created by the government or the local bodies for the general public, but due to lack of poor civic sense, these facilities are not maintained. You create a toilet, go after 3 days, see the condition. In Delhi, before the Commonwealth Games, Municipal Corporation of Delhi had set up waterless urinals. A new technology had come, candle-based waterless urinals. Some sample toilets were created, and after 10 days, me and my commissioner, municipal commissioner, we went for inspection in Paharganj area, and we saw people doing potty over there. So I think there is a lot which needs to be done, and this is something which should start from the very early part of their life at the primary school level. So here we can talk about it. We created anti-littering laws, but you see what happens everywhere. After the functions are over, see and go and see those grounds, how dirty they are. So when we talk of developing smart cities, the point which has been raised is very, very valid. We must also focus our attention how to create smart communities and how to inculcate the better civic sense so that we can present ourselves in a neat and clean atmosphere. Thank you.
Thank you for that, sir. I'm Dr. Dias from Goa, and I would like to congratulate all the panelists for the wonderful presentation. Just a comment, not a question, is that when we're thinking of smart cities, we should also think of disabled-friendly cities and cities that are friendly for the elder community, because this is the future. We would have to have cities that would make it easier for the elders to roam around. Thank you.
Well, I'll just take this. Well, this
you answering something? Yeah, I'm Subhash Faldesai, Chairman IIT. My question to the Chief Secretary here, particularly when we are trying to have IIT Park just near the prime city and the capital city of Goa, Panjim. We need to analyze the impact that is going to happen, because it's very close to the capital city here. And in these directions, we would have to have the details and the data, how many families will come and stay around, and for them, the health facilities, the education facilities, all infrastructure need to be created. And my second question is, all those people who come for the infrastructure creation, they don't migrate, and how to take care about all those families which are not required after their presence is not required after a particular assignment or a job is done, but they still go and make this environment polluted and congestion happens. Primarily we see in fact when if it takes place in Goa, we have to literally put off our working force or offices closed because it is the congestion. So how are we going to address about the IT park which is very near to the Panjim city? So
I think very good question. This definitely raises important issue of creating social infrastructure along with developing the IT park. As you are already aware, sir, this park is located very close to the Panjim town, maybe within 5 to 7 kilometers, and on the national highway. So the families who will be definitely moving because of the development of these IT industry here, I am sure that they will find themselves parked somewhere near the Panjim town. They are necessarily not going to be accommodated there. So as far as city is concerned, city provides ample, you know, amount of infrastructure in terms of housing, water facilities, schools, other social infrastructure. There should not be any shortage on that account. But your second point is more valid. What happens at the time then the industry, you know, grows, their construction activities are there, a lot of migrant labor, other people, they come. Generally what happens when the project is over, these people are left over and then they are just creating slum type of habitation. I think with proper management, IT department and the PWD, we should be able to control that situation. And the moment, you know, these things are noticed, they should be, you know, taking task at the proper time. I don't think there will be any problem in terms of shortage of water supply, electricity and other civic infrastructure facilities over there, sir. We are properly planning it, sir. Thank you.
Actually, the way we were planning cities earlier, different land uses, that we are a housing land use, we have industrial land use, we have commercial land use. So we are actually, what we are observing very closely in Delhi, that we are moving away from it. We are moving into mixed use development, that the place where we live is the place where we work. So a lot of these problems regarding transport is taken care of in this system. Thank you.
This concept of mixed land use and the land use policy, this is very crucial for the urban development and you plan the cities and settlements. Delhi's example is that they said that this is a use, you have segregated uses, and then if you change the use, it is a violation and there will be a penalization. And now they have come across to mixed land use. They have come across. It's a well, I think they came late, but they learned the process. But in Goa, I remember very clearly, is that we did not have we have a mixed land use policy. And when the problem happened in the Mideast, most of the people in Goa are working in the Mideast, and they were just thrown out of job, and they certainly had to come back in large numbers. And the mixed land use policy helped them actually to settle and start a business. I think that would be help in a big way. Thank you.
One last question, if anyone has to speak. One last.
Sir, Goa being a very, very small state, you know, there has always been this issue of garbage disposal. It's a very small state. It's been very susceptible to this. So, but apart from garbage disposal, there is another problem, is that is of garbage collection. And I'm saying this because I belong to Pernem Taluka. And it's basically more or less in North Goa, it's a very, very, it's a, you know, it's basically villages, small villages with houses spread across in small, you know, communities. So is there any plans on basically, you know, an organized garbage collection? Because typically this problem becomes much more acute during the tourist season. So 6 months, the problem is always there, but 6 months a year, the problem becomes even more acute because of the tourist season, where a much larger amount of, you know, garbage is generated. And it's a very, very, you know, it's a very beautiful, as a very beautiful state. So there are, from where I look at it, there are two parts of the problem. One is, of course, garbage disposal in a small state like this. The second part is garbage collection. Thank you.
I think 2-3 months ago, the government has drafted its own action plan for disposal of solid waste. And we have already filed an affidavit in the National Green Tribunal, Delhi. And door-to-door collection of segregated waste is the norm as provided under the rules. All the village panchayats and all the municipalities have been given direction to put in place a mechanism within 3 months' time. Some of the municipalities have fallen in line. You are based in Goa, you must be knowing, Madgaon, till 6 months ago, had enormous problem. They have 20 wards in the municipal council. All 20 wards have fallen in line. They are now collecting door-to-door segregated waste. Panjim Municipal Corporation was already doing it. Other municipalities have started. They are taking off. Panchayats, there is a little bit of problem. There are issues. We have collected, we have distributed them bins, separate, you know, household wise, so that the people can give their waste in segregated form. Then the collection mechanism already put in place. This is as far as collection is concerned. Within 6 months, I hope the situation will improve. As regards disposal is concerned, government has set up, planned to set up two plants. One in Saligaon, already the work has started. One will come up in Kakora. 100 TPD per shift, 8-hour shift capacity we are going to create there. Our basic problem is plastics. Now on the plastics, we have already entered into an agreement with one Chennai-based company, MK Aromatics Limited. They will be taking care of collection of all the plastics because all our beaches are full with plastic bottles, PETs and all those things. So they have also decided to set up a facility in Pernay, and that again will, you know, help in creating some sort of facility which will give us oil as the residue, and the government will earn some sort of receipts out of it. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request Mr. Shashank to close up the session.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gaur. Thank you very much, respected Chief Secretary and the esteemed panelists on stage for this very crucial discussion on building smart cities. And we had the perspectives from across all the states, and also we got to listen to Honorable Chairman of Infotech Corporation Goa also about the idea of smart city in Panjim as well. So with a note of thanks, I request Honorable Chief Secretary to present a memento to our esteemed panelists as a token of thanks. To start with, Ms. Namrata Kalsi, who is Deputy Chief Architect of Delhi Metro Corporation. A round of applause for ma'am, for Mrs. Kalsi. Then Sri Rajiv Yadwanshi, Commissioner, Com Secretary, Department of Urban Development, Andaman and Nicobar Administration. Sri Prashant Chaudhary, Senior Director, Sales, Government, CA Technologies. And last but not the least, our moderator, Sri Gaurav Jaisinghania, in charge of Smart City Cell, Bhopal Municipal Corporation. I request Mrs. Kalsi to present a memento to Chief Secretary Sir as well for his very thought-provoking address on this concept of smart cities and letting us know that smart community is rather more important to build smart cities. Then I request all the esteemed panelists for a group photo with the mementos. And then we will move on to the next topic, which is role of software technology parks in India. With the role of STPI, Software Technology Parks of India, in promoting IT.